right, we'll get going. So Daniel Haas from Toyota is going to come up and talk about the automotive industry. A fantastic and interesting conversation with Daniel a couple of weeks ago. He grew up in Japan, which I found fascinating, a country that I love, and really passionate about omnichannel in the customer experience. You know, an industry that's being disrupted, new market entrants, the pace of change around electric vehicles, the blurring of the lines between home, business, and mobility. So, Daniel, please come on up if you would. I hope that's woken the audience up.
Yes, hello, good afternoon. So I'm going to share with you some stories and some insights about digital transformation, especially how Toyota Europe is using this in order to drive customer experience. But maybe just when we start, a few words about me and my background, because I'm responsible for digital experience at Toyota. I grew up in Japan, where I lived for 10 years. Afterwards, I came back to Germany. I studied in Berlin, and I started in consulting. Then I tried myself in a startup company for web-based dealer solutions, and it went terribly wrong. So I ended up with Toyota, where I had the opportunity to work with both brands, Toyota and Lexus, in different functions. In these Japanese companies, you are able to move around a lot. So I was also working for Lexus in strategy and customer experience, as well as a Toyota and brand. But I would like to start this by telling you one story. It's a story about my childhood, actually, which kind of impacted me, and I come back to it from time to time. So basically, as I said, I grew up in Japan. It's a very nice country. People are very friendly and very forthcoming. But you need to have, if you are there, a registration card. And the foreigners, they need to have this registration card, which is, by the way, called alien registration card. And you need to have a fingerprint on this registration card. So, which normally you can say, okay, but there are only two group of people in Japan who need a fingerprint on their registration cards. These are foreigners and criminals. So, during the time while I was there was a lot of debate about this, because it's discriminating, it's really not respectful, and these poor foreigners, you treat them like criminals. But the government in Japan said, no way we are going to change this, it's going to stay like this. But there's something about the way people feel and think about it. And when you go to the administration and the municipalities, the people who actually had to deal with you while you asked for the registration card and do all the signatures and give the fingerprint, they feel a bit guilty about this, because they know it's a very embarrassing, it's a big pain point for the people who come there. So I remember when I went to the office to get my renewal, the person greeted me and said, yes, thank you. We prepared everything. First you sign here, then you get the ink, then you give the fingerprint, and then you can wash your hands. So I did everything, and then when I did my fingerprint, he came with a hot towel, like you get in Japan when you go to a restaurant, so that I can wash my hand, and then he thanked me, and then the process was over. And I kind of liked this experience, because in that office, they tried to do everything possible in order to reduce that pain point as much as possible. And I think it shows also that no matter what your responsibility is, no matter how much of this journey or process you can impact, you can always make a difference, and you can always apply a customer-centric mindset. And that's why I like the story, and I wanted to tell it in the beginning, because this customer-first mindset, which is a very Japanese mentality, is also something which is embedded in Toyota. So Toyota is basically founded on the principle of customer first. When you join the company, one of the first things they explain you is that the founder, when he built the cars and there was a problem with the customer, he went there in order to look at it and take care of it, take care of the customer and do everything. And this is something which is then being really incorporated in the way we do business. And in order to bring it to the customer, traditionally, it has been the people, the dealers, the people working in the retailerships. Those are the ones who are facing the customers. They are making sure to portray this message, to portray the customer experience. And if you build up this right mindset and mentality and training, you can deliver quite something. But we all know things are changing. digital is becoming more and more important. So all of a sudden you have the dealers who can apply this customer first mindset, and you have this digital channel, which is a bit like it's a different channel. And how do you apply the customer first mindset? How do you apply the same level of experience to this one? And this is a big challenge which Toyota was facing. And every brand is facing this, who has this multiple channels. And so our challenge was, in order to engage in digital, to say we have to find a way to bridge what we do in digital and we would do in retail, in order to provide one coherent experience, in order to make sure there's one voice, one experience, one relationship, that there's this one way to deal with the customer. So this sounds all very logical. And then there's one thing which we focused on, and this is with the goal to provide a memorable experience. And just to explain how we structure this, basically, the starting point could be something random. Random doesn't always mean bad. It means just you don't know what it's going to be. It could be that you interact with somebody who's really doing great, but it could be also the other way around. So now, to bring this to predictable, of course, you need processes, schemes, measurement. You need to make sure that the control is coming to the company so that the experience can be directed and can be structured and standardized. But this doesn't deliver memorable. For memorable, you always need a human touch. And I'm going to come to that also in a minute. But anyway, in order to provide this, there's the idea of thinking omnichannel. And we heard it already before, and this is like the big word, omnichannel, multi-channel. No, it's omnichannel. I remember always in the beginning sitting with consultants telling me, Daniel, omnichannel. Anyway, but it's something which, in principle, it's very easy. You say, customer, and no matter how he engages or he and she engages with the company, there's consistency, coherency, you can switch from one to the other channel. The only problem is, in order to do so, you need to make sure that there is one source of truth in order to provide this. And this is really the big problem I think we are facing, and I'm sure many companies are facing. I'll give you some examples later on of other companies. But the challenge is, we have, Toyota Motor Europe, we are covering 28 markets, 50 languages, several products and services, so many divisions, organizations, data sources are just endless. And we are the ones who we want the customer to look at this as one. So how do we look at the customer? Actually, if you look at reality, we look at the customer in all different pieces. One is knowing a bit of this data. Sometimes it overlaps. Sometimes it's incremental. Sometimes it's contradictory. But this is the way we are looking at the customer if you look at reality. So how are we going to provide a coherent message if this is the view we have on the customer? So any transformation we have to do in any way we want to achieve omnichannel means that we really have to change the way we do business. This cannot be solved by just a little project and looking in, so like, let's do things differently, let's clean this up. It doesn't work like this. It really means like it impacts legal. How do you share data? How do you work together? How do you agree on common processes between different legal entities? These are all things that fundamentally have to be changed. So it was very clear at a very early point of time that in order to do something, you need the motivation to change, because I remember having endless discussions on this one, and there was no willingness by some parties because everything was going fine, and from their perspective and their responsibility, everything is okay. So there has to be the motivation to change. There has to be the willingness to challenge conventions, because things are being done in a certain way, but they will not be done in the same way anymore. And there has to be the mindset of improving constantly, of Kaizen. Right? We heard this also today in different ways. Kaizen is a Japanese word, right, used as part of the improvement concepts which we do. So this is what we needed to all agree on. And it was not so easy with the company to get this point of time to really understand what it is. But once we had everyone together, once we had the different areas saying, yes, we have to change. Yes, we have to really work on this one. And we got the management commitment. We got some money for it. Then it just couldn't go fast enough. Then everyone wants to see results and says, no, I want to see something. What are you doing now? When is the next result you provide? But if you look at what we have to tackle, these are fundamental issues. These are not things you solve in a day. So it's actually it's a big problem. All of a sudden, there is this dilemma. So what is now more important, just to generate quick results or to generate lasting results? Yeah. So lasting, well, you build something, you know you can use it, you can expand it, but it takes time, right? Quick results sometimes also have the advantage. Sometimes you have to throw them away. And I noticed in the time I've been working on these things, every time I did a shortcut, in the end, I paid double. And I know it before I do it, but sometimes you cannot prevent it because it's also good to have quick results, to show some things, to have an example, to have kind of motivational items to test out things. But this is always a dilemma. And then the other thing is then the balance between local initiatives and central initiatives. If you want to be cost conscious, because investments are huge, they should be done centrally and then leveraged across all the different markets. But local initiatives, they are more agile, they can do quicker, they can act. And you cannot tell everyone, stop innovating, we will do it centrally. And you know, maybe in a year or 2 years, we have a big backlog. You have to understand, we will come with something. It's always a big dilemma you have to get through. So overall, the only way to really achieve something is to work together and to work across silos and really to break them and to make sure that there is kind of a unity. So that's why I think this South African saying is very relevant, right? But how do you really work together? Because we saw all the issues, all the problems, we saw the items, but how do you get a common way of working on things with across legal entities, across different organizational units? So customer journeys is, if you ask me, one of the core items in order to create this. Ah, now I see that this is so the customer journey is, it helps in order to create some common ground. It helps to create a common understanding about what are the different areas we are working on. And so we started to get everyone together in order to look at, so how what are the different journeys actually our customers are facing? And if you do some kind of exercise like this with people who have been working in automotive for 20 years or even longer, and you tell them, come on, let's have a workshop and look at the customer journey. I mean, basically you're told that you're an idiot. Everyone knows everything. I mean, working on this for ages. And there's a problem. A lot of times, process and journeys are mixed up. And I think a lot of people working in companies for a long time, they know the processes inside out and very well, but this is not necessarily the journey a customer is going through. So one of the things we did, I got more than 40 people, I remember the first workshop, into the room from different areas, really going through the different items and understanding what are the customer journeys in order to have a big picture. And then we started also to have different sessions to focus on one or the other item. And putting the people in the shoes of the customer, really giving them exercises. All of a sudden, they had to do things they never did as a customer. Because you see it always the other way around. You don't see it from the customer point of view. And often there are arguments like, no, this is the way it has to be done, otherwise we don't earn money. And then you ask, but is a customer willing to do it that way? Oh, customers would hate it. But that often it's this dilemma. And if you put yourself in your shoes and you say, but in the end we don't have time, right? There are all the arguments against it. But it really, for me, really putting these things on paper, these things agreeing on the journeys, really brought us to a level where we have a common language, and then with all the areas, we can talk about what we're talking. So now, I think this is a bit messed up. The thing is that across, if you look at the entities which are involved, there's so many, and they're all working on the same journey. So normally we look at journeys from, this is the journey and this is what I contribute, so I deliver this. But if you work with all the others together, it means you have to jointly work on changing the way we serve the customer. And that task becomes huge very quickly. And it becomes like an like if you just think about like how much you have to coordinate, where you have to check to adjust the systems and the processes, it becomes like an impossible task often. So it's like doing the impossible. So it's important to prioritize and to break this down. But then this is the next problem then. How do you prioritize? how do you prioritize what to focus on? So if you look at customer journeys, what we know is we know the needs of the customers, we know the pain points of the customers, and we know the expectations they have. So we could say, if we now focus on what to repair, how to become omnichannel, what is the first, let's go for the biggest pain points. Let's fix the biggest pain points. That's a good way to prioritize. Because if we would get all the pain points out of the way, I think we would do quite well. But then there's always this argument, but how much money do we make if we fix these pain points? Because some of these might be nice to do, but it doesn't bring us anything back. So maybe let's focus those items where we have the biggest business opportunities. And then, but some of these are really difficult to implement. Why don't we do the easy, the quick wins, right? So it's always a constant balance. But for me, what is the most defining item if something works or doesn't is the willingness within the organization. If you don't have somebody from the business who is behind it and driving it, it will not work. Things like this cannot be left to like the customer experience department or to the digital department. It just doesn't work. It has to be the business who's driving this and owning it and taking responsibility into driving this forward. So now, that was a lot of blah, blah. So now I would like to give you one example. One example where we did it concretely, and don't worry, these pictures I left small on purpose because I don't want you to read them. I just wanted you to have a bit of a feeling and about what I'm talking about. So one of the journeys we identified and said, let's fix this one, was the recall journey. I'm sure many of you are driving a car, and I would guess that some of you had been made subject to a recall. A recall is nothing bad. Normally, just for your information, if there's a recall, the probability that something happens to your car is 0.0 something. But still, it is a measurement which is very strictly regulated, and it's a very sensitive process which the company has to go to, which basically means recall all the products which could be potentially affected, repair them, and bring them back. So now, this process, that's what you see on the left side. This is the as-is, and you can see it's a quite lengthy process. So from a customer perspective, usually it starts by hearing it about it maybe on the news, but not knowing is my car in it or not, then maybe calling the dealer. The dealer maybe knows, maybe not, depending if that dealer has the information. Then at some point you receive a letter, usually a registered letter, which is very pleasant, in order to ask you to come to the dealership. Then you call the dealership. Normally the first answer is, we don't have any parts right now, but call us again in a month. Then you can call again in a month. You can come to the dealership, they repair the car, and you leave, and the service is for free. Anyway, but that's normally the experience. And if you look at it, when we started it, I remember, luckily we had a business sponsor, which was very good, to challenge the conventions, but no, legally we have to do it this way. There's no other way we can do it. But then going through it step by step, right? Why is the information coming only through the press? Because legal is very concerned that anything leaks before, because it's a very delicate topic and we cannot communicate to anyone else before the press. So normally nobody in the company knows, but wouldn't it be better for a customer when it's announced to have some immediate information online available? No, it's a no-brainer, right? It's just that then the communication department has to prepare several documents, not only the press statement, but also the internal things, and the marketing department has to make sure it's incorporated on the website. Very simple things to follow, right? The next thing is, wouldn't it be good if you can look up your car and find out, is it subject to the recall or not? The database exists. They are just developed in such a way that it's for a customer not understandable if you access that data. So it would require revising, translating this. So that's no problem, can be done. Just a bit of work, right? Then you can come to the next step. The other thing is, wouldn't it be good in order to have the dealer contact you rather than the other way around, or to make sure that with the next service it can be combined, that the recall is done at the same time. And so these are all the things which can be all developed step by step, and a lot of things are possible. Some things are not, but a lot of things are possible, but they just require a bit of work and a bit of changing the way we do things. But just for you to know, the other thing is, there are so many departments involved, and everyone has a different role and different objective, right? The legal wants to make sure, right, that everything is done properly. The quality division wants to make sure as many people as possible come back to have their car serviced. Marketing wants probably not to, let's not talk about this, right? So there are all the different objectives you have in the same game, and that's the problem. The objectives, if they are not aligned, then it's difficult to break through anything. So that was just an example about the recall. So if you can imagine this for other things. But then looking at this, like from working on it, I mean, I'm also a customer for other things, right? So I recently bought a pressure cleaner, right? So this water thing. So, and I could really have empathy with that company because I got the box. I wanted to clean the terrace. I opened it, and I had to assemble the parts, which is fair enough, right? I mean, otherwise it wouldn't fit into this box. So I got a little manual with it, black and white, on this paper with 28 languages of explaining something I didn't know, but it had pictures to explain me how to assemble. But these pictures were very poorly printed, so I saw number one, number two, and then I couldn't see it anymore, so I didn't know what to do. So I went online, I checked for it, and I found a nice YouTube video from somebody. My name is Joe. Let me show you how to assemble this machine, who explained it very well. So I did it. Then anyway, I was done, and I said, I will do the cleaning another day. And then a week later, I got it out of the hut in order to then clean the terrace. I just had to put the accessories on it. So I got the accessories, and with the accessories, beautiful pamphlet in nice colors, nice images, explaining how to put the accessories. Clearly a different agency supporting them than the one for the manual. And then in the middle was and download the app. Oh, an app. So I downloaded the app, very easy. And then I started the app, and it says, in order to connect your device, scan the IQ code on the package. The problem was the package was already on the déchetterie of Brussels, but then you could like do like the VIN code or whatever. And then the app started and says, and these are the 18 steps to assemble your product. So it was very nicely explained, unfortunately too late for me. But anyway, so and there you can really see how the company is organized and who's working with whom and how they struggle to get these things together. But I think it's not bad because they're all, well, not all. Like I think the ones who are with the product, and they didn't hear the shot yet. But the others, the accessories and the app, they really did the utmost in order to get things developed. And I think, and that's basically, if you look at it, it's kind of multi-channel. But if you can connect this, and it's not a big step anymore, then I think they're really set up in order to deliver something nice and impactful and beautiful. But anyway, this again comes back. If they had common objectives, I'm sure they would get there. But I don't think they have yet. But anyway, but this is what I believe. So anyway, so this was basically the key thing I wanted to share. So basically, the willingness to change, the willingness to change conventions, right? And to improve things consistently across the different areas, to work across silos, and to have common objectives. So with this one, you can get with digital from, I still have one story, but from random to predictable. But in order to get to memorable, you need more. And we had it before also, I think it was very nicely said, but that there's an element of mindset, of culture, a human touch, which is then really making the difference. And this is something you cannot put into a set process. You cannot define, you cannot have rules about this is the way you do it. It is something which people have to understand and get. And there I would like to just close with a story about Lexus. About a cigarette lighter. And I think I like it because it always explains how the Lexus mindset is embedded in the way people work. So there is in the United States, there was a professor called Dr. Jones. And he had a premium car and was not a Lexus. And he, living in LA, and he brought it to his maintenance. He used to drive through traffic there, and then he had it maintained, and then he drove back to his office. And when he arrived, he noticed, the cigarette lighter is missing. So he called the garage and told them, I just came back. The cigarette lighter is missing. Oh, Mr. Jones, no problem. Just come here. We give it to you, or we give you a new one, whatever. Don't worry. Just drop by. And he said, is this really a good answer? 45 minutes to get there, 45 minutes to get back. And this is what they tell me. So he called the other manufacturers and the dealers and asked them, listen, this is what happened to me. And then what would you have done? Oh, Mr. Jones, we would have come and brought you the cigarette lighter. And the next one, oh, Mr. Jones, of course we would have come and brought you. You wouldn't have to come back to us. And he also called Lexus. So everyone said the same. Then 2 hours later, his secretary comes and says, Mr. Jones, there was somebody from Lexus here. He brought you a cigarette lighter. And this is the story. which we always tell also internally when people start at Lexus. But this is the mindset, right? And this is things I just think you cannot teach. People have to understand. People have to believe in, because it's a different situation. Anyway, this is what I wanted to share. If you have any questions.
Love please. That. Thank right. you so yeah. much, Dave. So when I spoke to Daniel a couple of weeks ago, he's very quiet, very considered, and I thought, session straight after lunch, I'm going to have to do something to warm the audience up, but I didn't realise that, I'm not sure if you know you're hilarious or whether you do know, I think you probably do know. Any questions?
Patrick?
Yes, we do. Hello? 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 No, I think I'm there now. Thank you. We have one question that's come in. How do you experience the impact of cultural differences to implement the customer journey, thinking like a Japanese company, which is quite hierarchical?
Yes, yes. No, it is. So the cultural differences is an issue, because already translating what happens in Japan to what happened in Europe or in the Western countries in the United States, there's a big difference. Things which are natural in Japan are not natural in other countries. If you go country by country, there are also, of course, then differences, and the expectations and the expressions and also what you consider as appropriate is different. And so basically what we do is we localize trainings, and we do trainings locally with the different people. And I just remember when I was working in Lexus and we were introducing training programs across the different areas. I came to the Netherlands, and then I said, but it's not possible. In the Netherlands, the people in the north are different in the south and different in the west. And I thought it takes 2 hours to drive through anyway. But that was. But what we usually also then do is then to put the customers, I think, the people in the shoes of the customers, and that helps always to experience what to make sure people get what is the right mindset that has to be brought alive.
I have another question for you. You will not like this question. Is self-service something you've already put in place for the online experience, and does this help the seamless customer journey?
Which service?
Self-service.
Self-service. I don't know what self-service...
For the online experience, so if there are any issues with the car, the customer would go online to see if they could resolve it themselves. For example, like Stephanie's example, kind of similar to this morning when she was talking about her car braking.
So, interesting. So, self-service, of course, in such a way that you fix the problem. You have FAQs, of course, which explain you then always what you do. But a self-service method like this, I have not, like...
I guess it's the maturity, Daniel, of processes that may historically involve a customer having to go through the effort to find the telephone number, call, versus almost decision trees in your digital channels to get to the same outcome?
Yes. Well, I mean, through our digital platforms, it's much easier to engage and to contact, right, and to be helped. But yeah, I think there's maybe... A car is also a very complicated product, so we don't... Yeah, so you want to deal with a dealer.
Anyone right? offering self-service, service, just come and speak to you, yeah? Yes.
Anybody?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. You got it?
Thank you. First of all, I want to say I'm so impressed by your presentation skills. It's just so enjoyable to hear you speak. It's unbelievable. Okay. And in the age where the attention span is 5 minutes, I think it's commendable. So I wanted to say that. And the second point, you said at the end with the Lexus example, that you don't think that you can teach this type of skills or the mindset. And this is actually what I do. I teach my students to develop this type of mindset. Can you elaborate why you think you can't teach that?
No. So I think this is, I agree with you. I think you can teach a lot. But if the base principles are missing, I think then your investment is in vain. So, by the way, when no, so, so no, there's a lot. No, so there's a lot you can do. I think there's a lot you can teach. There's a lot of you can develop people, and we realized at some point, by the way, that we were working with retail staff, and really bringing them through courses and through trainings, but we didn't focus on the leaders of those entities. So the bosses did not understand fully what their employees were learning, and that was a big mistake. And so fixing that one is, of course, helping. We have actually training programs now in place called Best Retail in Town, where people even go to Japan as part of like a certain sequences in order to really learn and to go to the basics. So this really helps in order to evolve. But I always believe is that some people have a mindset and a thinking which is going in the right, which is in line, which helps a lot in order to really accelerate and to bring it somewhere and to make it lastable. When Lexus started their business in the 80s, by the way, I think it was in 81 in the United States, Toyota was a very successful automotive company in the United States. So they had dealers, they made a lot of money. And then they opened up the Lexus dealerships and they had 140 points to fill. Open points. And today, of course, the Toyota dealers were the first one in line in order to say, I would like to get the Lexus franchise in my area too. But they put a lot of attention to make sure that they select those dealers who already have the right understanding and the right mindset in place. And they didn't fill all 140 places because they were not convinced by the mindset of the people. Because they said, we want to build this brand on, right, this experience. So if we fail on this one, we will fail with the brand. So they rather took the approach to grow it slower than to escalate. So
it comes a little bit back to the first story you told about the fingerprint and the yes. alien process. You know, it was still delivered with that human spirit. So there's got to be that kind of from within. It's not okay just to hide behind the process, I guess, is it?
So you have to repeat this for
me. No, don't worry. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I just looked it up. So multi-channel, multi means many, and omni, all. And I think omnibus is also that all together. So how did you convert it inside Toyota, this all together, really to change and to include the leaders, but all the others as well. So it's a tremendous shift you reached. So
yes.
Do you have some tips?
I think omni-channel is always a bit... And this is what I wanted to say indirectly. It's always a bit division, of course, like ideally, because multi-channel is relatively, you can say it's relatively easy. You have a responsibility and then you just do in your channel and whatever you think is right to do. To bring it together is then really to break those silos and to connect and to have the same source of truth, which you can apply so that you get the same data about the customers, about the products and everything. And this is, I think, always the big gap. And I think a lot of companies are talking about omnichannel and omnichannel, but in reality, it is not omnichannel. It is still multichannel. But I don't think it's a big problem. I think it's anyway a step in order to get there. This is what I think. But anyway, but in order to get there, the only common objective is the only thing which really helps. Yes, please.
Victoria?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. I think it's an interesting point. Yeah. No, we're just trying to get to omnichannel. No, don't bring me. the thing is, like in our industry, it's maybe different because there's a lot of effort put on searching, identifying products, and looking at, is this the right model for me if you buy a new car, right? Then at some point you would like to touch it and test it, so you might go to a dealer. Then you want to make sure that somehow what you looked at before is or the dealer knows about it. When you test drive it, you might want to decide later on to purchase it, to reserve it. Maybe you want to do that at home. So that's what we're trying to achieve in moving forth and back. If you go to used cars, it's even more, because then there's a scarcity of products. You have to make a decision quickly. So these are the things where we try to combine that what you can do online and offline, basically. Or if you call a call center, that they have the same information and can support you. So this is why for us in that process, it's a relatively lengthy process also in an automotive to purchase or to make a transaction. So from that point of view, I think if you get to this connecting them in a seamless way, I think we are doing a good step ahead. But I think it's an interesting point you're bringing. Yes?
You were talking about prioritization,
yes,
of doing things, because the list is always too long. And you said that like the willingness of the business to change is for you the most important one. But what if it's a really important change to make, but the business doesn't see it that way?
Yeah.
How would you approach it?
It's a problem. It's a problem. And no. Because I had in these activities one case. I'm not going to tell you which one now, but where it was exactly that way. It was there was a lot of push to change something because it's important, but from their business side, people did not buy in and they did not see the necessity, and it was a complete failure. This willingness to change and to challenge convention, because you can always say things are not possible and cannot be done. If you look at like this little example I had here with a recall, the starting point was not possible, cannot be done. Yeah, legal constraints, process requirements, and whatever. But if you really have a can-do attitude, there's so much you can change. And I think this is like the value of this is always so enormous. And that's why I think it's a real problem if the business doesn't buy in. And I don't know how to solve it. We're dealing with humans, right? So then.
You say it was a disaster, so you did go on?
Yes. Yeah, but didn't result in any. Say again, the
So the disaster or the challenge that you faced is the burning platform. So in order to get that change in place, that you can't make that problem any longer.
No, but you can have different views on, and it's not always so it's not that things are standing still always, but in order to the thing is it's having somebody who's driving it and willingness to work across silos, and those two together, and often you deal with people who have done their jobs for a long time already sometimes, right, who maybe are more or less inclined, interested, if they're not incentivized, if they don't see the overview. Sometimes there's less in for one area and more for the other, and it's very difficult to get that change always done. That's why sometimes these quick wins help to show examples and to motivate. And the other thing is the task is sometimes so big that it's just so depressing already that you don't even want to start, because you think it's like if you have homework to do like this, you don't even want to start your homework because it's too much. And this is what I think is often blocking them. It's a very difficult item.
I think we have time for one final question.
I was just wondering, how do you measure success? So with your process improvements or whatever activity you have locally, globally, how do you measure success, yes, and how do you communicate that back into the company?
So that's luckily, because digital plays a big role, it becomes easier and easier, I think, in order to measure success, because you can measure a lot of things you do. So the thing is to define the KPIs, to look at the KPIs, and to look at where we increase our conversions, our transactions, and so on. So we always try to make everything measurable. And to set targets, we always set targets, even though in the beginning we have no idea what is actually achievable sometimes, if it's new things. But we always say, let's set a target, and then let's revise. At least we have something to work against. But it is also a problem. We have always dashboard over dashboard, and then we find out actually as we move on, some of this information is completely useless. Others is more important. So it evolves also. Yes, so ideally you have a journey KPI, but sometimes you have process KPIs, sometimes you have like step KPIs. Often, I mean, if you really look at business success, it's of course then the conversions and the results. We measure satisfaction throughout the whole processes, either in the traditional way of servicing people or when they do work digitally with tools where they have a possibility to give feedback immediately why they actually engage with our platforms. So there are different ways in order to do so. That there's a lot of data which is then consumed and used.
Brilliant. Daniel, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Round of applause.